Welcome to Her Remarkable History. Remember to support, subscribe. Mary, Queen of Scots. Happiness in France to a widowed Queen, 18. Mary Stuart, Queen of Scotland, was born just 1 week before the death of her father, King James V, in 1542 at Linlithgow Palace in Scotland. Mary was now Queen of Scotland when she was just 6 days old, and Henry VIII made a bid for control of Mary as she was only an infant. But her mother became regent, and in 1548 Mary was sent to France to grow up. Mary was the daughter of King James V of Scotland and his second wife, Mary of Guise. Mary's great-grandfather was Henry VII, making Henry VIII her great-uncle, and Elizabeth I was Mary's cousin. Initially, Mary was betrothed to King Henry VIII's son, Prince Edward, but this didn't please the Scottish Catholics, and the betrothal was annulled because they refused to ratify the agreement. England had separated from the Catholic Church, and the Scots didn't want to be associated with that. Henry, in anger, because he wanted to control Mary, started a war between England and Scotland, and this war was later known as the Rough Wooing, to try and change the minds of those who denied him. French troops helped the Scots fight the English, and in return it was agreed that Mary would marry the heir to the French throne. Mary's mother was French, and because the Scottish had a long-standing alliance with France, Mary was sent to live in the luxurious French courts, and she was betrothed to the then 4-year-old French heir. Mary was only 5 at the time. Mary was then to be the bride of the young French Dauphin, Prince Francis, in order to secure a Catholic alliance against Protestant England. Mary took her place amongst the royal children of Henry II of France and Catherine de' Medici and shared a room with the eldest French princess, Elizabeth. However, she was given precedence over Elizabeth and Claude, both as a sovereign queen and the betrothed of the Dauphin, Francis. Mary became attached to all the French children. Unfortunately, soon struck up a close friendship with Francis. Mary was brought up in a magnificent royal palaces, and she learnt to speak French, Italian, Latin and Spanish, and was taught to sew, write poetry and play musical instruments. She was also very fond of riding and hunting in the French countryside, and religion, of course, was a major part of her life, and she was brought up in all the traditions of the Catholic Church. Mary's position as Queen Regent of Scotland was no way near so important in the French minds as her role as a future Queen Consort of France. French interests in Scotland were purely self-interested, and it was to enable them to threaten England and have a springboard to invade their old enemy should England again encroach on French territory. The whole thrust of Mary's education was thus to make her Queen Consort. Scotland would be ruled by a French nominee and then united with France through Mary's putative son. Mary continued to speak Scots, although her main language soon became French. Scots is not Gaelic, but an Anglo-Saxon language similar to English and mutually intelligible, but more divergent than those modern Scots and English are. Her other Scots companions were then also sent away. 2 years after her arrival, Mary had the delight of a visit from her mother. In a touching scene, Mary, who had been practising a speech of welcome, broke all the rules of etiquette and ran towards her mother. In 1553, tensions broke out between the French and the Scots over Mary's position. The princesses, Elizabeth and Claude, were considered old enough to leave the nursery and join their mother, Queen Catherine, at court, and the French, including Mary's uncle, the Cardinal of Lorraine, thought that she should have her own royal household. The problem was that the Scots crown could barely afford her maintenance as part of the French princess's household. The French troops that Henry had sent were welcome in that they gave some protection against the English, but the cost of them was enormous, and the resentment was building. As Mary got older, she became more independent, and as the years went by, she developed an interest in her own country's affairs. She wrote regularly to her mother for updates. She trusted her mother completely and even sent her blank letters with her signature for her mother to use. The lack of money created tension, and arguments arose between the members of her household and Catherine de' Medici and her governess. This led Mary to develop a gastric problem that would flare up whenever Mary was under any stress for the rest of her life. During Mary's absence, the movement for religion reform had spread in Scotland, and Marie was battling to maintain the Catholic faith against the Protestant lords, who came to be called the Lords of the Congregation. To conciliate them and to ensure that they too supported Mary's marriage, some of these lords formed part of the negotiating party sent to France. Also in the party was Mary's half-brother, Lord James Stuart. He was leaning towards Protestantism, but was still a supporter of his stepmother, Queen Marie. In April of 1558, Mary, aged 15, married the then 14-year-old Dauphin Francis in the Notre Dame Cathedral in Paris. The terms of the marriage treaty were, on the face of it, reasonable. Francis was recognised as King of Scots, in right of his wife, with the government to be carried on in the absence of the couple, by Marie de Guise. State documents were to be signed by both of them, with Francis's name in the superior location. If Mary were to die without children, both Henry and Francis swore they would uphold the succession of her next heir, currently Aaron, who had been sweetened with the grant of a dukedom. Once Francis ascended to the French throne, the countries would be ruled jointly, and their citizens would be naturalised in both countries. Their son would inherit both crowns, but if they had only daughters, the eldest would become Queen of Scots. Should Mary be widowed, she would have the option of remaining in France as a dowager queen or returning home with her substantial dower. So far, so good, but Mary was persuaded, and there is no record of whether her consent was freely given or whether she had to be included to sign three secret documents. These passed Scotland, in the event of her death without children, to France, together with her rights of inheritance in England. They also agreed that Scotland would repay the costs incurred by France in aiding its defence and invalidated any future acts of the Scottish estates that Mary accepted, which were in opposition to these articles. It is probably that Mary believed that Scotland would benefit enormously from being, effectively, an outpost of France. In November of 1558, Mary's cousin, Mary I of England, who was also Queen of Spain as the wife of Philip II, died. Most Europeans and many people in England believed that Mary of England's half-sister Elizabeth was illegitimate and therefore ineligible to inherit the English crown. In their eyes, Queen Mary's rightful successor was Mary, Queen of Scots, descended from the eldest daughter of Henry VII. Unsurprisingly, Henry II was firmly of this belief. To have his daughter-in-law of Queen of England would be an enormous benefit to France, breaking the alliance between England and Spain. He immediately arranged for Mary to be proclaimed as Queen of England, Scotland and Ireland, naturally overlooking the English claim to the throne of France. Mary and her husband quartered the arms of England with those of France and Scotland, and they were frequently displayed in court ceremonial, as well as being engraved on their household plate. The action of Henry II had a most damaging effect on the rest of Mary's life. Aged only 16, she probably had little say in the matter, but it is made that the English government, which had immediately accepted and proclaimed Elizabeth of Queen, deeply suspicious of Mary. As a French-influenced Catholic, Elizabeth's new Protestant government was certain that Mary had her eyes on the English throne, a view from which it never wavered. Henry II and Philip II of Spain finally ended the long Italian wars with the Peace of Chateaucambrai signed in April of 1559. The treaty included provisions for Mary's sister-in-law, Princess Elizabeth, to become Philip's third wife, and for Princess Marguerite, sister of Henry II, to marry the Duke of Savoy, Philip's cousin and chief commander. A double wedding was planned, and it was during a celebratory joust in late June of 1559 that King Henry was killed. Francis became king, and Mary became Queen Consort of France. Mary and Francis, although matched to marry by others, became great friends, and although still only children when they wed, they may have actually grown to love each other. But Francis died prematurely in his teens, and the crown was then passed to his younger brother. On the 16th of November 1560, Francis complained of a severe earache. His condition rapidly deteriorated, By the 27th of November, it was obvious that he would soon die. Mary and Catherine attended him lovingly, but he died an agonising death from an abscess in his inner ear on the 5th of December. Mary was devastated by grief. Francis had been her closest companion since she was 5, and the whole thrust of her upbringing had been to cast them in the role of monarchs, spouses and lovers. She withdrew to her chambers, draped in white. After her period of total seclusion ended, Mary received the English ambassador, who wrote that, now the Queen was not subject to the submissive role of wife, she was showing herself as having both a great wisdom for her years, modest, and also a great judgment in the wise handling of herself and her matters, which, increasing with years, cannot but turn greatly to her commendation, reputation, honour, and great benefit of her and her country. She thinketh herself not too wise, but is content to be ruled by good counsel and wise men. Mary's reign was brief, and taking into account that her mother, who was acting as regent for Scotland, had passed away in 1560, it meant that Mary had to return to Scotland in 1561. On the 18th of August, she sailed into Leith, dressed in mourning. Mary then travelled to the Palace of Holyrood House in a grand procession, where the way was lined with a cheering crowd. Mary was now a foreign queen in her own country, and times ahead were going to be hard. Thank you for watching, and to support, please subscribe to Her Remarkable History. Thank you.